generally smile. By nature, you can smile. But if you cannot smile, that tells you something. So, when you look at a baby, a little child, the little child it smiles so beautiful. That baby's beautiful smile has the power to make everyone happy. The reason for talking about this luminous mind is discourse of the Buddha. Because this morning I had that experience. We had a service, there was a little baby. And everybody was happy. The baby was smiling, so beautiful, so pleasant to look at. And the kids over there, they were also happy. They were playing with this smiling baby. And the adults who were looking at the baby, they were also happy. So this, you know, the baby's mind has the potential, has the power to make everyone happy. So now, we also have the same smile. What happened to us? What happened to us? Now, can you really smile right now? Yeah? Or is there something that's blocking that beautiful smile? So, we have this beautiful mind, this happy mind. But as we grow up, as we become interested in the things out there, the interest in the things out there, you know, defy our mind. Now look at your evolution. There was a time that you were just happy with the toys. You used to play with the toys. And whatever you had within your reach, you were happy with it. Then you started, you know, walking around, and you go to different places, and then you become interested in other things. And as you keep growing up, parents took you to the what you call junior kindergarten, then the senior kindergarten. But the very first day, and of course, you did not want to go to kindergarten. You cried. No, I want to go. I want to stay with mommy. I want to stay with daddy. I want to stay home. But then the parents, maybe by force, it's okay, no, you have to stay here. But parents did that out of compassion, because we need to get good education. So then, you know, after a while, you forget about the parents. Then you saw other friends, the kids. You became interested in them. And then, when your parents came to pick you, you said, "Mommy, I met this friend, I met that friend, now I have one friend, I have two friends, I have three friends." Then you also know their name. Then you begin to talk about the friends. So now what happened? Slowly and slowly, you're growing up. You have become interested in the things out there. So now, as you became interested in the things out there, the external things triggered the internal things to become like what we call those in Buddhist terms we call kilesa, or in Sanskrit we call klesha. Klesha are the negative emotions, negative thoughts that have defiled, tainted our mind. Now we can highlight several defilements, several taints. Greed is one, desire, craving, the other defilements. Anger is another defilement. Jealousy is another defilement. And all these defilements just destroy our the happiness, the joy, the peace, the nature of the luminous mind is to generate happiness, to make you happy, to create the good mood. Now if you're becoming moody, that means you're holding on to something. It could be an image. It could be a particular story. And you're holding on to this either with greed, craving, desire, or with anger, hatred, aversion. As long as we continue to cling to these stories based on the negative emotions, the happiness is not possible for us. The freedom that we are looking for is not possible for us. And this is why we are seeking something out there. Right? That's why we have become interested in the, let's say, the parties, nightclubs, or people, money, the house, So there are a lot of things. The more we become interested in these things out there, the more we become defined. Have you ever thought about this? Think about this. You know, like this is a form of meditation. You know, meditation. The whole purpose of meditation is to develop our awareness, sati. Like in day-to-day life, when you deal with the things, now see whether this is true or not. Then from your own experience, you realize, my goodness, I thought I was fine. But it seems the more I have, and the unhappier I become. It's like today I had to do kind of counseling session on the phone. And of course, I try to help people in any means possible. It could be phone, it could be internet, it could be, you know, a person-to-person counseling session, or whatever it is. Whoever comes to me, I try to help that person. So this person moved to one of the South American countries. And this person was here, was married, had two kids. But again, due to maybe the powerful desires, defilements, this person left everything behind here, moved to South America. And this person thought that he or she would be happy over there. But again, of course, there's no end to our desires. There's no end to our cravings. That's an endless thing, and it led to another big disaster, like emotionally this person cannot handle it anymore. Now the mind has been already defiled by certain impressions, imperfections, and now chasing those external pressures, then the defiled mind has become more defiled. And it seems nothing is clear. Nothing seems to be clear. So living now a very emotional and painful life. So two experiences. In the morning, the baby's beautiful smile. Now in the afternoon, it's an adult, right? Who is very unhappy. So now, what can we do about this? There is a hope. Buddha said that mind is luminous, mind is pure. This is being defined by these incoming thoughts, impressions, images, perceptions, the things out there. Because I think this is why Buddha also talked about the sense restraint, indriya sangha. Maybe I need to talk about this later in another talk. Indriya sangha. When you're communicating with the world through the senses, eyes, ears, nose, tongue, body, and mind. And when you see the things up there, you feel like everything is so beautiful. I mean, it's okay to look that way, the positive way. But your perception is not really a good perception. You're not seeing the reality as reality, the truth as truth. It's the things are just misguiding us, like, you know, when we see colorful things, the light falls onto that object, and then we begin to see colors, then we say, wow, what a beautiful thing. As soon as we define and interpret that it is beautiful, then what happens to us? Longing, desire, wanting arises. Then wanting is such a powerful one that we give in. We become a slave to it. See, giving in, it indicates how powerful it is. How powerful the defilement is. We don't see, we don't discern the things as they are. By the time we realize, we see, sometimes it's too late. Right? But we are practicing meditation to go back to this original, pure, luminous mind. So, if something is disturbing you, you don't have to jump into a conclusion that, my goodness, that's it, my life, the rest of my life, I'm going to live a painful life. No. Don't jump into that conclusion. Now what we have to do? It is like the water. Let's say the lake or the pond. If the water is tainted by some chemicals, right? Let's say the water is water. It's pure. It is like, you know, like if when you add some dye stuff into it, let's say if you add red stuff into the red dye, into the water becomes turns red. If you add black, water becomes black. Then we call it the red water or the black water. But again, water. Right? Now the water that we are drinking, thanks to the technology, they are using this mechanism and purify the water, and they are distributing the pure water to all the residents. But now imagine if you to drink tainted water, going to make you sick. So in the same way, the defiled mind is making people sick. Defiled mind is killing people. Consciously or unconsciously, not knowing this, but they keep going after those things. And they are making sick mean that is making their life miserable. But we can, and the way we purify the water, we can purify the mind. That's why Buddha taught Dhamma, said, I'm teaching Dhamma to purify the mind. Like, there's a summary of the Buddha's teachings. In Pali, we say, Sampapapasakarana. Not doing any bad deeds. Kusala Sukha Sampada, doing the good deeds. Sachitta Pariyo Dhamana, and purify your own mind. So we are practicing Dhamma to like avoiding doing bad leads to purification of the mind. Doing good leads to the purification of the mind. And then purifying the mind, that is meditation. And meditation, we are practicing meditation to purify our own mind. This is the key objective of meditation. Meditation is not about this and that. Those are byproducts. But the whole purpose of the practice of meditation is to purify the mind. Now why? Because Buddha knew that as adults, we have this defiled mind. The root cause behind all suffering, all problems, is this defiled mind. The craving is one of the defilements. So now, how do we purify the mind? Every time you let your mind visit the past, the past is going to create a lot of defilements. Every time you let the mind to talk about the future, it's going to create a lot of defilements. Okay? Why? Because whatever experience you had in the past, it could, if it is a pleasant experience, then you want it now and in the future. Want it, again, want it, right? And whatever unpleasant experience you had in the past, if you think about it, then it leads to like not wanting based on anger. There are some emotional resistance going on. So it's the conflict between two things. Wanting, not wanting. Wanting, not wanting. Wanting, not wanting. Wanting leads to more desire, more craving, more. Not wanting leads to, it's not happening, it leads to anger. Other things happen. So, Meditation is all about being right here in this moment. Just by being in the moment is going to secure your well-being. Like what? It's like, you know, being in the moment will not lead to any emotional reaction, maybe the negativity is. Maybe whatever you are experiencing in the moment, it could be pain, it could be thoughts, it could be other kinds of experiences. This is a way of letting the covered things come up. Whatever things we have suppressed all these years, it is a way of letting them come out. It's like, you know, the more you push the ball into the water, right? The more you're going to feel uncomfortable. When you're strong, you can keep pushing, but you can't do it every day. So pushing is not the way to do things in certain ways, like purifying your mind. So it's okay, let it come out. Stop pushing. Let it come out, come to the surface. Then once, you know, things come onto the surface, you know what they are, then what you do, you simply do like, you just let them go. So, present moment awareness, present moment living helps you not only maintain luminous mind, and if there are defilements, then you can see them and remove them. So three things to do. Avoid doing all the bad things, that's one way. Second, do good. And the third, and meditate. Now what is meditation? The meditation is not about thinking. Meditation is not about doing things. Now, how sometimes we are here to do meditation. This is not about doing. Meditation is not about doing. Meditation is all about being in the moment, being fully aware. See whether defilements, the visiting thoughts, see whether they are good or bad. So, if there are unwholesome thoughts coming, you don't let them occupy. You just unwelcome them. You don't welcome the unwholesome thoughts. You just say, thank you for coming, but this is not the right place for you. Right? So you just, with much gratitude, you just let them go. So when you keep doing this, then your mind remains stable, clear, luminous, and this luminous mind itself will make you happy. Then you can smile. You're not going to be moody. Though things are happening, they won't disturb you. Why? Because we have stopped emotionally reacting to those things. You become powerful within. You become peaceful. You become blissful. You feel feel the bliss in the moment. That's the power of the luminous mind. So what you have to do is to continue practicing meditation. Present moment is the only refuge that we all have. Present moment is the savior. Present moment is the liberator. Present moment is the Buddha, if you want to call it. It makes you happy. It liberates you from all the attachments. So you can apply this into your day-to-day life when you go out. Of course, you all are householders. When you deal with see whether things are disturbing you or not. See whether you're getting attached to certain things or not. See whether you're getting angry or not. And when you become aware of all this, then what you do is, now I know that if I let you in, you're going to defile, change my mind. So, you just underline right away. If you let the visiting apostle thought settle down, it's going to destroy the peace of mind. It's going to taint the mind. With the tainted mind, you cannot see anything. It is like, you know, the sun, the moon. The moon is pure. But the drifting clouds obscure the moon. That's why the moon cannot shine. If you want to shine with happiness, joy, let the drifting thoughts, incoming visiting thoughts, go away. Do away with those thoughts. Don't let them occupy you. So for this, you need a very powerful mindfulness, sati. And we are practicing meditation to cultivate mindfulness. And when we bring everything into the range of this mindfulness, then everything becomes clear that you know what to do. This depends on you. So you have to do it. So you have a luminous mind, be happy for that. If you think you don't have it now, you can go back to it. So let the luminous mind come up by practicing this meditation. So now let us practice meditation. Yes, I'm going to do a little blessing chant. 바로의